Well, this morning we are probably in my favorite of the 12 minor prophets. As Matt already said, it is the prophet of Jonah. And I think the reason I really like Jonah is because the style of this prophet is very different from the 11 other minor prophets. Last week we looked at Joel, whose style is very typical prophetic literature. The word of the Lord comes to the prophet and he preaches it. And the tone will vary. Sometimes it is strong, even threatening. Sometimes it's mournful and pleading. Next week we'll see it could be sarcastic and a bit angry. Jonah, on the other hand, is entirely narrative. We have a story here, a story that has a plot, dialogue, and there's really no obvious interpretation of the details. So we have to work a bit harder to figure out what the message of this prophet is. And there are rules to interpreting Old Testament narrative. We don't just get to make stuff up. The structure of the plot is very important. So we watch what happens next and so on. Keywords, repetition, themes that are recurring in the story are great clues to follow. We have plays on words that will sort of direct us to other parts of the Bible, kind of plant thoughts in our mind. We have allusions to other themes in the scripture. And probably most importantly, we have dialogue. And who gets to speak in the Old Testament story and what they say and whether what they say is right or wrong is critically important to understanding this story. So we have to mind this story. We have to pay attention to the details. We have to relish it. We can't just rush through it. We have to think about it. And I have yet to meet a person who doesn't love stories, especially stories that have layers of meaning, and the story of Jonah is certainly one of these. Now, in the E-News on Thursday, we have been sending you a challenge to read the Minor Prophet before you come here on Sunday. And I know Matt did that. Thank you. Did anybody else get to read Jonah this week? All right, well, like one quarter. It just helps you to be in context. Next week we're in Amos, so I challenge you to read that. They're short books. Follow along with me in your Bible, please. Not all the scriptures will be on the screen. So Jonah chapter 1, verse 1, it begins with the call of God to the prophet. The word of the Lord came to Jonah, the son of Amittai, saying, "Arise, go to Nineveh, the great city, and cry against it, for their wickedness has come up before me." Now, this is a prophetic formula. The word of the Lord comes. That is how every prophet's job begins. We see that Jonah here is the son of Amittai. Again, we don't know much about Jonah as we don't know much about Joel. His name means something like a dove or a bird. Some scholars suggested that a good translation would be bird brain. Jewish tradition holds him to be the son of the Zarephath widow who died, and Elijah brought him back from the dead. So we don't have much evidence besides Jewish tradition on that, but if that is true, he would have been a prophet from Galilee, as Gath was near Nazareth. Now, instead of the normal message to preach to the people of Israel, as most prophets do, Jonah is given this task: arise, go to Nineveh and cry against it. And of course, prophets do what God tells them to do, right? No matter how odd the request might be. We know that Ezekiel was told to lie down on his left side for 390 days, then on his right side for 40 days, to shave his head and to go around the city burning his hair here and there. So prophets do as they are called to do. But I want to pay attention. I want you to realize the dual nature of every call that God gives to the prophets, to people in the Bible, and to you and to me. We often tend to reduce God's call to the task around which the call is wrapped up. However, each call of God is far more about than the thing that God is asking you to do. You may have sensed a call to serve in a certain ministry, maybe to consistently pray for someone, to serve someone in a particular way for a time, to go to school, to move, to change jobs, to become a foster parent, to adopt, whatever it is, there's a call where we feel God is asking us to do something. But in each of those calls is wrapped up this call to not just do, but to become, to be formed by the experience, to become aware of maybe some immature, unhelpful patterns in your life and let go of them. And through the experience, adopt new patterns, helpful, more Christ-like. The missionary call is very much like that. I have been called to a number of short-term missions. Each time I went, I was very excited about how I would contribute and what I would give to the people, how I would be helpful. And it took me a few trips to realize that the far more important piece is the work that God is looking to do in me during the experience. So I would encourage you to assess any call that you may have with this dual lens. What is the task that I'm being called to? But what is the change? What is the work that God is about to do in me? So Jonah has a task: arise and go to the Assyrian capital of Nineveh and preach. But the goal that God has in mind is change. Change for the Assyrians and also change for Jonah. But to our great surprise, in verse 3, Jonah arises, all right, but not to go to Nineveh. He flees to Tarshish. Jonah rose up, verse 3, Jonah rose up to flee to Tarshish from the presence of the Lord. He went down to Joppa, found a ship which was going to Tarshish, paid the fare, and went down into it to go with them to Tarshish from the presence of the Lord. If you click, Gloria, you should see the next verse. And I broke down the structure of that runaway response of Jonah. The presence of the Lord is the phrase that brackets what Jonah does. And if you think about it, the phrase flee from the presence of the Lord is elsewhere in the Bible as well. Adam and Eve hid from the presence of the Lord. Cain, after killing his brother, fled from the presence of the Lord. So fleeing from the presence of the Lord is very bad. It speaks of a very serious break of relationship with God. On the map, you see that Jonah goes as far as he can in the opposite direction from where God sent him. And he's very clear on where God wants him to go, but he chooses to go elsewhere. And fleeing from God's presence is always a downward journey. Watch how many times the word down appears. In verse 3, he is going down to Joppa. The city is today called Jaffa in Israel. It's a beautiful port city, and many important things happen here. This is where Peter raises Tabitha from the dead, and this is where he has a vision that leads to the full inclusion of the Gentiles in the church. In verse 3, we also see that he goes down into the ship. And as Jonah is down in the ship, in verse 4, the Lord, and the word is literally, picked up a great wind and hurled it on the sea. And there's a great storm so that the ship is about to be shattered. And the sailors become afraid. Everyone is praying to whatever God they know. They have to throw the cargo overboard to lighten the ship so that they can survive. But Jonah is sound asleep in the hold of the ship. Now, often we use peace as a sign that we are doing the will of God. Here is an exception. You can actually be outside of the will of God and be perfectly at peace because that is what you want to do. So if that is the only sign, I would say, you know, check again. Then the captain in verse 6 calls a prayer meeting. He wakes Jonah up and he says, we're all praying here. Let's pray, get up and cry to your God and maybe he will help us. They also decide to cast lots. Let's figure out which one of us is at fault for bringing this storm about. And sure enough, the lot, whether it's drawing straws or whatever, it falls on Jonah. In verse 8, you see this barrage of questions. Who are you? What did you do? Where are you going? Where did you come from? And look at how Jonah answers. He says in verse 9, I am a Hebrew, and I fear Yahweh, Lord God of heaven, who made the sea and the dry land. Here is Jonah's declaration about who he believes God is to be. And he claims to fear, that is to respect and to worship God. Now, the fact that he calls himself a Hebrew is very telling, because the people of Israel never refer to themselves as Hebrews. They call themselves the people of Israel, the sons of Israel. Hebrew was a derogatory term actually applied to them by others, similarly to the term Anabaptist, which was applied to us by others. And it means a Hebrew is someone who is on the fringe of society, someone on the edges, someone who doesn't really belong. And the fact that Jonah refers to himself in this way is very telling. He doesn't feel like now he is part of the people of Israel. He is a man on the edge, on the fringes. So when he tells the sailors that in verse 10, they've now become extremely frightened. Fear is a very key word in Jonah. And they want to know, first of all, how could you do this? Because they realize he's fleeing from the presence of God. But also, how do we fix this? What do we do? And Jonah's answer is in verse 12, well, throw me into the sea. This storm is because of me. I know that. Last week, there were locusts. This week, there is a storm. Both times, some kind of a calamity is God's way of getting your attention. So Jonah says, throw me in. Now, do you think there is another option for Jonah at this point? Does he have to be thrown into the sea? If you were his advisor, do you see another way? Yes. Yes, there is another way. There is an option. But it seems like Jonah would rather die than follow God's call to Nineveh. Now in verse 13, we see that these pagans, the people who do not know the Lord God, refuse to let him perish. Even though this calamity is his fault, they lost their cargo, they lost their prophet, they might lose their ship, but they don't seem to hate Jonah. They're not vindictive toward him. In fact, they show compassion for him. They care for him. They try to do what they can to save his life. They row toward the shore as hard as they can, but the storm is just getting worse and worse. And finally, in verse 14, they pray to Jonah's God, Yahweh. And they say, we earnestly pray, O Yahweh, they call God by his name, to save us, do not let us perish. They ask God for salvation, and they also ask God for forgiveness for the fact they're throwing this man into the sea. And they say, as best as we know, we're doing your will. They pray to Jonah's God, and then down he goes into the sea. In verse 16, we see that after this, they actually worship Yahweh through this fear, which is inner respect, through acknowledgement that he is God. They offer sacrifices and they make some vows to do more for God later. And at this point, we should be seeing an amazing contrast. These pagans and sailors, no less, sorry, Bruce, are far more godly than this man of God, his prophet. They pray. They respect God. They take pity on Jonah. They do what they believe is right to save him. They are doing God's will as best they know. And even when they throw Jonah into the sea, they're doing that with full interaction with God. They are engaging with God while Jonah is not saying anything to God in the process. And so in verse 17, Jonah goes further down as he is swallowed by the fish. Here he doesn't die. He stays alive for 3 days and three nights. And I will leave it to your imagination what this time might have been like. But I want you to think how much like being in the grave it would have been. It would have been dark. It would have been cold, tight. And Jonah is literally decomposing in the digestive juices of this fish. And it takes 3 days of this ordeal before he calls out on God. for his salvation. Chapter 2 is the theological gem of this book, which is Jonah's plea for salvation. And I encourage you to just read it on your own. Ask God to tell you what he wants to tell you about himself through this. But there are declaration after declaration, and it shows us that Jonah knows God extremely well. He really is one of his prophets, and he does understand God's character. Some of the things we see in his prayer to God is that, first of all, God answers our calls for distress. How quickly we ask for his help is up to us. Dallas Willard says that God is happy to let you handle your circumstances on your own if that is what you wish. If you want God, however, involved, you just need to ask. Second of all, that God is sovereign over all the consequences. You know, Jonah does not blame the sailors who threw him into the sea. He understands that this is a result of his own doing, and ultimately it is all in God's hands. There's no bitterness toward others. Next, we see that God rescues even the guilty. Even if your adversity is a direct consequence of your disobedience, turn to God nevertheless, and his mercy and compassion will prevail, and he will deliver. In verse 6, we see that God saves even at the brink. He says, "Water encompassed me," in verse 5, "to the point of death. The deep engulfed me. Weeds were wrapped around my head. I descended to the roots of the mountains," that is, to the very bottom of the sea. "But you have brought my life up from out of the pit." It is not too late. You are not too far gone. Your life is not too complicated for God to stage a rescue. And in verse 7, we see that God is actually ready. He stands at the ready to save. Jonah says, "While I was fainting away, I remembered what you are like, God, and my prayer went out to you." Now, whether this was a semi-conscious, murmured, whispered, or just thought prayer, it's enough for God to move into action and save. In verse 8, we see that God saves all who turn to him. It's a beautiful verse. We have it on screen. And actually, it says that those who worship to any substitute for God, and the book calls them worthless idols, they miss out on the covenant to love and faithfulness that is otherwise available to them. When we choose to not call out to God and involve him, we forfeit the hope of receiving his help, his grace, and his mercy. And it is a choice for a hard life full of struggle. Those who worship worthless idols forfeit the mercy that could be theirs. And finally, in verse 9, simply, God saves. Salvation is from the Lord. So no doubt that Jonah knows the character of God, his power, and his generosity. In verse 10 of chapter 2, the Lord commands the fish. It spits Jonah up on the dry land, and we see the fish here is a better servant of God than Jonah so far. In chapter 3, the word of the Lord comes to Jonah a second time, a second chance for the prophet. "Arise and go to Nineveh, the great city, and proclaim to it the proclamation, the message that I am going to give you." And now Jonah goes, and he does go to Nineveh the way God said. And the Nineveh is apparently a huge city. It takes 3 days on foot to cover it. Now, Nineveh is on the Tigris River. It is today called Mosul. And I heard it on the news again this morning, right? It is the last stronghold of ISIS, and they're hoping in the next few days to recapture the city and take it back from ISIS. It was the largest city in the world until 612 BC. It was built by Nimrod. It's mentioned in Genesis 10. It was known to have a temple to the goddess Ishtar, which was called in Assyrian Nina. And Nina was always represented by the figure of a fish. So Nineveh is the city of Nina, or city of Ishtar. And so Ninevites are kind of the fish people. So Jonah's fish experience would have been most impressive to the Ninevites. And so we see that God redeems our experiences even when we are off call, right? When we are off track, he uses it all for his purpose. And here, Jonah could have saved himself and others a lot of trouble if he had just done this in the first place. Now, God gives him the message, and we see in verse 4, Jonah begins to go through the city. He preaches for one day, and his message in Hebrew is 5 words. 40 days and you're dead. That's basically his sermon. Matt said, I don't even think he made a plaque. He sort of minimally discharges his duty here. He's not going out of his way to preach the message. But he does discharge his duty. In Ezekiel 37, we see that if God says that someone is about to be judged and you know it and you don't tell them, that you are actually responsible for them. Paul shares the same sentiment in Acts chapter 20 when he says to the elders of Ephesus that, you know, I have not hesitated to say anything that would be helpful to you all. I taught publicly and privately. And in verse 26, he says, therefore, I am innocent of the blood of all people here because I have told everyone what they needed to know. And in fact, this is how I came to be saved, because a woman felt convinced by God that if she didn't tell me, that God would deal with her, right? So that's why she told me about the good news of Jesus Christ. Now what we see then is the response of the Ninevites. Jonah chapter 3, verses 6 to 9. When this message, 40 days and you're dead, reached the king of Nineveh, he gets up from his throne, he takes off his robe, covers himself in sackcloth, and sits in ashes. And the robe and the throne, of course, are his position of control of his kingship. He lays those aside and he humbles himself. Then he issues a proclamation to all the people in the city, and he says, no animals and no people are to eat or drink, a complete fast. And in verse 8, all people and animals are to be covered with sackcloth. Imagine that. And all are to pray, earnestly call out to God, and they're all to turn from their wicked way and from the violence that is in their hands. Verse 9, we see the hope. Who knows? Maybe God will turn and relent and withdraw his burning anger so that we will all not have to die. This is the most complete description of repentance that we have anywhere in the Bible. They do everything that the prophets are calling God's people to do elsewhere. It's modeled by the king. The sackcloth is this humbling. Ashes is the sign of remorse. No food or water. Heartfelt prayer. And the action of actually stopping to do that which is wrong, turning from evil, turning from violence. So we have these outward signs of contrition and a call to earnest inner turning. Now this is the same understanding of God, same response actually that David shows when his child is about to die. Right? He humbles himself, he repents, he prays in hopes that God will change his mind and save his child. Who knows? God may relent. So does God change his mind? And if so, when does he do that and why does he do that? Because we have passages like Numbers 23, verse 19 that say God is not a man that he should lie. He's not a human being that he should change his mind. Has he said and will he not do it? Has he spoken and will he not make it happen? But there are also other examples of God changing his mind, most clearly in Amos chapter 7, 6, where it says, Lord, the Lord changed his mind about this. And he said, this too shall not be what he said would be. So what do we do with this? Well, the first statement in Numbers 23, God is not a man that he should lie, not a human being that he should change his mind, is a formula. It is a set way of saying something, and it confirms that God will not change his mind about the particular thing in that context. In Numbers 23, it is about blessing Israel. Elsewhere, it is about taking the kingship from Saul. So wherever we have that statement, it is actually referring to a particular thing, not a general characteristic of God. Because God actually often makes conditional statements. Exodus 32, verse 10, when the people make the golden calf, he says to Moses, "Now let me alone so that my anger may burn against them, that I might destroy them, and I will make of you, Moses, a great nation." And you see that it actually invites intercession. Right? Let me alone means actually, because if you don't let me, I might change my mind and this might not actually happen. And we are a praying church because we believe that God responds to us. And together with God, we can change the direction of events. Change is possible as God responds to us. Now, there are times when God will not change his mind. There are unconditional statements that God makes, or sometimes they're wrapped up in this oath statement, such as in Jeremiah 4:28, where God says, "Therefore the earth will mourn, the heavens will grow dark, because I have spoken and I will not relent. I have decided and I will not turn back." In other words, in this case, change is not going to happen. But essentially what we need to know is that God acts in response to the human heart. And so we see in Jonah chapter 3 verse 10 that when God sees what the Ninevites have done, how they have repented outwardly and inwardly, that they turned from their evil way of living, God relented concerning the judgment that he had threatened them with and did not destroy him. So God changes his mind as people change their hearts. God moves in response to the human heart, and his preference is always mercy, always compassion over judgment. As we get to chapter 4, we see the Ninevites are rejoicing, but Jonah despairs. This, in verse 4, chapter 4, verse 1, this greatly displeased Jonah. Whatever translation you have, there are all kinds of words that try to express how Jonah feels here. And he became angry. And this is how he prays. And this is actually the first time Jonah says anything to God. He says, "Please, Lord, was it not this what I said while I was still in my own country? This is why I fled to Tarshish, because I didn't want this to happen." His forgiveness of the people of Nineveh. "Because I knew that you are a gracious and compassionate God. I knew you are slow to anger, abundant in loving kindness, and I knew you were a God who relents concerning calamity. Therefore, God, take my life from me, because death is better to me than life at this point." And it is here that we actually see why Jonah fled to Tarshish. It is because "I knew this would happen." He knows God's heart, and he knew that even if judgment was pronounced, if there was repentance, God would relent and choose mercy. As God saved him in the fish, so God would save these Assyrians. And Jonah wanted to prevent their salvation at all costs. And then he says, "I would rather die than see them spared." Now, the Assyrians were a threat to the northern kingdom of Israel, where Jonah is from the very beginning of the nation until they eventually conquered the northern kingdom in 722 BC. This plaque is from the Assyrian palace of Nimrud, and it shows Assyrian soldiers attacking the Israelite city of Lachish. And you can sort of see at the back center that there are people impaled on stakes. We have other images that show them skinning the Israelites alive. They had terrible, brutal warfare and battle tactics. And it was, of course, Jonah would have hated these people. He probably knew people that the Assyrians have murdered or tortured, cities they have burned. Now, the question that we have to ask, are there people like this in my life? Are there people that I hate so much that I do not want them to be spared? Corrie ten Boom, you know the story. The Nazis actually, she was in a concentration camp. There was a particular man. He was particularly brutal to her sister, who died in the concentration camp. He was very abusive to her. And then she got to meet him afterwards, after the war, as she was preaching God's forgiveness and God's compassion. And he came to receive that compassion from her. Who is that person in your life? You know, for me, for a long time, it was the gypsies. I grew up literally being chased by gypsies. They were an issue in the country where I grew up. I was always scared of them. Watch out. You know, they were kind of the worst case scenario that could happen to you. I would plan my routes home from school, not the shortest way to go, but the way that had most visibility and most escape routes. Because a couple times a week, I'd be chased by a gang, a band of gypsies. And if you ask me a number of years ago, do these people deserve compassion? I felt zero compassion. And then somebody asked me a few years ago only, what do you think the solution is to the gypsy problem in Europe? And the answer was so simple. It's Jesus. If they have Jesus, everything will change. The church in parts of the world is certainly guilty of being hateful towards certain kinds of people instead of being compassionate, knowing that they need Jesus to be saved, to be enabled, to be renewed. Is there someone that you think ought to suffer, someone who should not enjoy the forgiveness, the peace, and the joy, the contentment that God brings? You see, unlike us, God sees the eternal soul in every person, and that is precious to him. And the challenge to us is, am I like Jonah, or am I willing to ask God for his eyes, his perspective for that person or for that people group that is so hard to love? Because compassion and forgiveness is actually the way to my own healing. And that is precisely what God is doing for Jonah. He's giving him his own perspective. And you see, Jonah cares about the plant that gave him shade and was unhappy when it died. And God is challenging Jonah's lack of compassion on these truly awful people who need the saving knowledge of God desperately if they are to become different. And those awful people, for us, is just one awful person, few awful people, a family member, a neighbor, someone who is the source of unhappiness for you. And wouldn't living for Jesus change that person? Would you be willing to pray for them and even share God's love with them? In Jonah chapter 4, verses 10 and 11, God speaks to Jonah. And he says, Jonah, you had compassion on the plant for which you didn't work. You didn't cause it to grow. It came up overnight and it withered overnight. Should I not have compassion on Nineveh, the great city in which there are more than 120,000 people who do not know the difference between their right and their left? God has invested into this city. There is a lot that is important to him in this city. Will you hate, or will you align your heart with God and love those that God longs to show compassion to? So we see this big God in Jonah. First of all, a God who is compassion. He has compassion on Nineveh, yes, but he has compassion on Jonah, I think, even more so. And he is so patient with him. And he contrasts his anger, God's anger, with Jonah's anger. In Jonah chapter 4, verse 4, and in verse 9, God asks the same question. He says, do you have a good reason to be angry? Or a better way to ask it, will your anger bring about any good? And Jonah says in verse 9, yes, it will. It'll bring about my death. Right? That's how angry he is. But God's anger actually brings about something great. It brings about the salvation of a whole city. Secondly, we see a God who is merciful. In chapter 3, verse 10, we see when God saw their needs, that they turned from their, the word literally there is evil, then God relented concerning the evil, which was their destruction that he planned, but this was evil to Jonah. We have the same Hebrew word. The what is evil to God versus what is evil to Jonah. To God, what was wrong was the destruction of the city. To Jonah, what was wrong was the salvation of the city. And of course, Jesus is the ultimate image of God's compassionate, merciful love to us. In Christ, God did for us what we cannot do for ourselves. He lived as a human being, limited as we are, yet in perfect relationship with the Father, empowered by the Spirit, loving God and loving others, and willingly taking on himself the judgment that is rightfully yours and mine. We also see a God who is powerful in the book of Jonah. The phrase God appointed the storm, he appointed the fish, he appointed the plan, he appointed the worm that ate the plan, he appointed the wind, he appointed the sun. God is more than able to take care of you. And we see a God who is very, very personal. He is highly engaged in a very personal way with Jonah, with the sailors, with the Ninevites, and even with the fish. There isn't a one-size-fits-all approach that God has with people, but he engages with us in a way that is very personal to us. And finally, a God who calls. And I want to ask you whether you are prepared to hear God's personal call and respond to it, better than Jonah, for sure. And God is certainly calling each of us here. He's constantly inviting us into something new because God has more for you than you are willing to settle for, more to do and more to become. Are your ears and eyes tuned? Are you ready to hear the call that God has for you? So that is the book of Jonah, a challenge to be more like the pagans and less like the prophet, this so-called man of God. To be a people whose hearts are aligned with the heart of God, who are willing to be the witnesses for God to all, and trusting that God will protect and sustain us in the task. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this story. My heart just breaks for Jonah, and I wonder how the story ended. Did he get it or did he not? Did he choose to stay in his anger, in his resentment? Or did his heart soften? Did he experience joy? Did he experience love and compassion for people that were so hard for him to love? Lord, we love happy endings, and I pray that for all of us here, those people that we hate, the people who have harmed us in the past, that you would give us your heart for them, that we would be willing to pray, we would be able to release them and so release ourselves from the harm they have done to us and align our hearts with yours. We thank you for the story. In Jesus' name, amen. I'll ask the worship team now to come up and lead us in the final song.